Okay. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for joining this session. Today, I will present the first study of my PhD that is about the sex difference in triathlon performance. Triathlon is a multi-sport event that combines three different endurance activities, such as swimming, cycling, and running over a wide range of distances. Since its inception in the early 70s, triathlon has grown rapidly in popularity. As highlighted by Millet, the physiological requirement for a triathlon performance are the economy or efficiency of exercise, the lactate threshold, the critical power or speed, and the maximal oxygen uptake. So this means that athletes with the same maximal oxygen uptake can have different triathlon performance due to different percentage of utilization of maximal oxygen uptake or different efficiency of exercise. So triathlon is an endurance sport, and we know that endurance exercise causes fatigue, which can be divided into perceived fatigability or performance fatigability. As for performance fatigability, we can define as the decline in an objective measure of performance over a discrete period of time. The performance fatigability during triathlon have been already observed by several researchers, mainly before and after the race. In the last years, our group have investigated performance fatigability by maximal isometric, voluntary isometric contraction of knee extensors during Olympic race or sprint race. In this graph, you can see the data of our study, and the total force loss ranging around 20% or 25% of pre-values in both races. It's important to note that the information about performance fatigability in literature are mainly obtained in male subjects, but we know that in triathlon performance there are sex differences. Indeed, Le Per have shown that men are usually faster than women. Indeed, in this graph, you can see the sex difference as percentage of total time for some triathlon distances, such as Olympic distance, half Ironman distance, or Ironman distance. And we can see how this difference change among the different distances. And this difference ranging from 10% to 20% of total time. These differences are likely due to physiological, morphological, hormonal, and psychological factors. Indeed, men are usually stronger and more powerful than women, while women present a higher percentage of fiber type 1, a better substrate efficiency, and a better muscle perfusion. As elegantly reviewed by Hunter, some of before mentioned aspects have been involved in the mechanistic basis for less fatigability in women. However, no information about sex difference in performance fatigability in triathlon are present in literature. So, the aim of this study was to evaluate the sex difference in performance fatigability during an Olympic triathlon race. In addition, physiological response to exercise and race performance were investigated. We recruited 24 participants, 12 women and 12 men, and here you can see their main characteristics, including the inclusion criteria adopted for the study. So we organized an Olympic triathlon race near Milan. The three athletes completed 1.5 kilometers of swimming in an artificial lake, 40 kilometers of cycling, and 10 kilometers of running on flat courses. And here on the right, I hope that you can see the video from the race. The performance fatigability was assessed before, during the transition, and at the end of the race by the evaluation of the maximal voluntary isometric contraction force of knee extensors, as well as the counter movement jump power. Overall, the men were faster than women, and here you can see the data from the total time. At the end of the race, the difference between men and women was around 25 minutes, and about the 13% of men time. The overall performance difference was likely due to difference in the cycling and running section. Indeed, these two sections present a significant sex difference, as you can see here. On contrary, women and men presented a similar percentage of maximal heart rate values during the race and a similar rate of perceived exertion at the end of the race. The values collected before the race in the resting condition confirm that men were stronger on the left and more powerful on the right than women. As for performance fatigability, the percentage decline in force at the end of the race was about 15% for women and 24% for men, showing that women were more fatigue resistant than men during all the time points in the race. However, we cannot have the same conclusion for the counter movement jump power, since it didn't change through the race for both men and women. So taking together these results suggests that men performed an Olympic triathlon race faster than women, and this was similar to previous finding, for example, from Lepere, that investigated the sex difference in performance in triathletes competing the Olympic distance race. Moreover, women presented a lower decrement in maximal voluntary submitted contraction force than men, and this is the first study that investigated sex difference in performance fatigability during an Olympic triathlon. The sex difference have been already studied after cycling exercise at a different intensity or after long duration running. And the data seems to not extensively confirm that women are less fatigable than men. And these heterogeneous results may be due to the fact that the fatigue is influenced by the duration and the intensity of exercise. And it's really difficult to compare different studies. In this study, finally, the counter movement jump power during the race was not different between women and men. This finding is in line with data in literature where studies results are not consistent in demonstrating that sex difference in fatigue response during dynamics exercise compared to isometric task. So further studies are needed to explain why power did not change during this dynamic exercise and which is the specific mechanism involved in this difference. So in conclusion, the results from this study suggest that women were less fatigable than men during and after an Olympic triathlon race, despite a similar cardiovascular response and the similar rate of perceived exertion. I would like to thank my colleagues for helping me conducting this study and all of you for your attention.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. Very Thank clear. So before opening the session for questions, I would like to take this opportunity first and ask you about you know, so you found that men and women were seem to be equally fatigued in this experiment, and this is the condition of the experiment. How much do you think we can trust these conditions? So how much can we say, for example, that perceived exertion is similar between men and women? I have no experience with that, but maybe you know something about that. And also, can we trust these average values of heart frequency, heart rate? Are there not differences if we had been able to look at the time course during each part of the triathlon. It's a long question, sorry.
Okay. I start with the first question that was about the perceived exertion by the women and men. I'm not an expert about the rate of perceived exertion, but we really familiarize our subject with the Borg scale, the 0-10 Borg scale, because we I didn't explain it, but we saw the participant before the race for the incremental exercise for taking the main anthropometric information and their VO2 max and their heart rate, maximal heart rate values. And in those sections, we presented the Borg scale to the subjects, and we asked to use it also during the training section to make more familiar to this scale. So all the subjects had the same familiarization with this scale, and we are quite sure that these are the real feelings by the subjects. And I don't know if I respond to your question.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. And about the second point about, you know, using average values of heart rate.
Okay. We use this. I use mean values of the section, because our participant use a heart rate band during all the race that was also a GPS. So it's a Garmin, mm-hmm. It's the Garmin, okay. And they use this heart rate band that was properly for the triathlon performance. And we collected all the data from all the race, and I average it with the maximal heart rate values reached during the incremental exercise. So it's that the percentage that I present.
Yeah, thank you. Are there any questions from our panelists? I think Wolfgang was first and then Marcus.
Thanks for your very nice study. I think it's important to get some more data what's happening in women. Nevertheless, I will start with the men group. You said there was a 25% decline in force. So this seems a lot, especially when we consider that the counter movement jump did not change at all. Can you compare that with the literature? Did others find that as well, such a big loss?
Okay. It's a really big loss. As I presented in my introduction, we have performed another study on only male subjects, comparing sprint and Olympic triathlon in men. And looking at the literature in this main topic, there are a lot of studies that investigate the fatigue in triathlon performance, but the most of the study are about the counter movement jump changing, that there are some studies that maybe have a really difference in counter movement jump, but also study where they didn't find any difference. Specifically in our study, we saw the same amount of fatigue. It was about 24% only in male subject, and in this study was about around 25. So it's really near and really comparable, this data. And it's a lot. And we ask also why we didn't found any difference in power and any difference in isometric contraction, but maybe it can be due to the different exercise task for assess fatigue, because we have investigate the maximal isometric contraction force of knee extensors in isometric ways. So, and we saw this difference and this decline in maximal voluntary isometric contraction, but in power, we didn't not see okay. this. So maybe it's due to this different task to evaluate fatigue.
Yes. And something, perhaps I got it wrong, in the introduction you said women, they have a very small difference during the Olympic distance in swimming. But yeah, then at the yeah. end you presented a study where it was 18%.
What I can...
At the end you presented a study where you said the swimming, the differences, sex differences in swimming performance are around 18%.
Yeah, indeed, in the study of Leper was quite a different distance, the sex difference in the total time performed. I don't know why in our study the sex difference in those section, in the swimming section, was not so big.
Perhaps another question, if you compare the different disciplines, swimming with running and cycling, where do you think is technique most important, or where do you have to, might experience make a bigger difference in which?
Well, looking at the men and women, we know that men are more powerful, as I said, and more strong. So the discipline where power and force is more important are, of course, running and cycling. So it's there where there is the main difference. And moreover, in swimming, we know that women are advantage because they float better. And so maybe they experience less fatigue and they are more advantage in this discipline than men.
Thanks.
Marcus?
Sorry, I hand over to Marcus here.
Thank you, Marta. Very nice presentation. I have nevertheless one very fundamental question. And it's about the method you, or the experimental setup you use. Because you want to show the effect of, or the sex differences on fatigability. But you have differences also in other parameters at the beginning of your study. So VO2 max is different, maximal strength is different. So how do you know that sex differences lead to the effects you measured?
Thank you for your question. That's a really big point. We include in this study subject with similar age and similar experience in triathlon and similar amount of training hours. So we try to not take as we know, men are more strong than women. So at the same level of performance in triathlon, we cannot have the same force between men and women, or the same amount of power between men and women. So we use this inclusion criteria in a different way, using age, using experience, using the VO2 max, and but I know that the evaluation before the race can be can bias our data, but we also normalize the data from their pre-values, so it's a percentage of decline from a different point. But it's a really good question. Maybe we can try to find some women that are strong enough to be comparable to men.
Thank you. Yeah, it's an interesting prospect. We will switch now to our next speaker, and
that is
Post. And the title of Matthias's presentation is Subjective Behavioral and Physiological Responses to Mental Fatigue in Sub-Elite Table Tennis Players. Matthias?
Yes, I'm now sharing my presentation, and I think that's okay now.
Yes.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction, Professor Sinus. So hi everyone, as said, I'm Matthias Proust. I'm a PhD student at the Free University of Brussels, more specifically at the Human Physiology and Sport Physiotherapy Research Group. Together with Lyons, we started a study on the subjective behavioral and physiological responses to mental fatigue in super elite table tennis players. And the first question we have to ask ourselves is, what is mental fatigue exactly? I'm sure everyone in the audience already experienced some mental fatigue, as it is actually a feeling that you can get after a long day of work, having several virtual meetings, or after having a tactical meeting at your sports club, or even after a long car ride with some traffic jam. You have some feeling, and it is really a psychobiological state, which is caused by prolonged periods of cognitive activity. Therefore, it can manifest itself on a subjective way, where there are feelings of tiredness, there is a lack of energy, and there is a decrease in motivation. But also on a behavioral level, there are some changes where there is a decline in performance, and more specifically in reaction time and accuracy. But also on a physiological level, there are some brain alterations, which can be a manifestation of mental fatigue. So we now know that what mental fatigue is, but what does it affect? We know that it affects endurance performance, such as running performance or bike performance, where there are already several studies who show that there are no physiological changes, but there is a decrease in performance due to mental fatigue. And on the other side, there are sport-specific psychomotor performances, such as racket sports and soccer, where decision-making, accuracy, and reaction time are affected by mental fatigue. Nevertheless, we know what mental fatigue is, we know what it affects, but the question remains, what are the mechanisms behind mental fatigue? The mechanisms on this are at this moment purely based on subjective and peripheral outcomes, such as the rating of perceived exertion and the visual analog scale for mental fatigue. So there is really a need for objective outcomes of mental fatigue. And this is where the electroencephalogram, EEG, comes into picture. There have already been some studies using EEG when people are mentally fatigued. And there has been a recent review of Tran and colleagues who looked at the spectral bands of EEG, where they found that the alpha and theta bands were affected by mental fatigue. They saw that these were really higher, and that can be linked to inhibition control and also a decrease in alertness. The only downside of this spectral power analysis is that it is an average over time, and that you lose the big advantage of EEG, which is actually the temporal resolution of EEG, which is excellent in my opinion. And therefore, it is maybe more interesting to look at the event-related potentials, because they represent an immediate change in brain activity due to a task stimulus. So, and this already have been linked to mental fatigue, where there are changes in latency and amplitudes, and where a decrease in amplitude is shows that there is less activation in certain brain areas. So it's really an extra addition to the search in the objective outcomes for mental fatigue. So therefore, we started a study where we wanted to look at mental fatigue within a visuomotor task while measuring EEG within our participants. Therefore, we have some hypotheses, where the first hypothesis is that the participants will have a higher subjective feeling of mental fatigue, that there will be a decrease in physiomotor task performance, and at last, that we will see some changes in the event-related potentials. To do so, we recruited 11 Super League table tennis players, 4 females and 7 males, of which you can see the characteristics here. Each trial, they fill out a pre-test checklist to make sure for their coffee consumption, the sleep, because we know that all these parameters can affect mental fatigue. They were recruited for a randomized counterbalance crossover design, which consisted of 3 trials, a familiarization trial, an intervention trial, and a control trial. Here you can see an overview of the experimental trials, where the participants had to do a flunker task and a visuomotor task before and after the intervention. The intervention was a troop task or a control task. I will come back on that later on. And during all of the trial, we have some psychological measures, such as the visual analog scale for mental fatigue, also motivation scale. We had the NASA TLX for the load. And then we also have some physiological parameters, such as the heart rate and, of course, the EEG, which could be the answer, or at least we hope, to the objective outcomes for mental fatigue. So this gives us some main outcome measures, where the flunker task is a first outcome measure, as we know that in previous research, this can be, it's more as a check to see if the people were really mentally fatigued, because we know that the decrease in accuracy and the high reaction time can be markers for mental fatigue on a behavioral level. We also hope the other main outcome measure was the visuomotor task performance, where the reaction time was important. The visuomotor task was a table tennis-like performance where participants had to stand in front of 6 fit lights, where they had to turn off the light when they turned on. Unless the light was blue, they had to ignore the light in front of them and turn off the light who turned on behind them. So there are 2 kinds of stimuli, the normal stimuli and the inhibitory stimuli. As we know that these inhibitory stimuli are more susceptible to mental fatigue. And at last also, of course, the EEG data are main outcome measures where the ERPs and the spectral power analysis are the most important one. The intervention was a 60-minute troop task or control task, where the troop task was individualized, and also and for the control task, it was a emotional neutral documentary about planet Earth. Then we had some other more secondary subjective and physiological outcome measures, which is the visual analog scale for mental fatigue. We had a motivation scale, as I said, the RPE, the NASA TLX for the load, and heart rate. So this brings us to our results, where for the first hypothesis, we saw that the subjective feeling of mental fatigue was elevated. So our hypothesis was confirmed. It was confirmed by the visual analog scale for mental fatigue, where you can see that just before the intervention, during the physical motor task and the flanker task, the people were at the same level of mental fatigue, and that there were no significant differences. But when the intervention started, the 60-minute troop task in the mental fatigue, we saw that after 15 minutes in the task, there was already a significant difference within the participants. Also, after the intervention, we saw that there was a significant difference of mental fatigue. So we know for sure that the subjective feeling of mental fatigue was present during the visuomotor task and the flanker task. This was also confirmed by the mental cognitive demand scale of the NASA TLX. For the second hypothesis, we were looking at the visuomotor task performance on a behavioral level. And there we saw that there was a decline in the visuomotor task performance. Unfortunately, due to some technical issues, we only have the data from 8 participants. But even with the data of the 8 participants, we see that there was a decline in performance. So there was a higher reaction time. They reacted slower to the stimuli between the 2 conditions. Also, when looking at the 2 different stimuli, so we have the normal stimuli at the left and the inhibitory stimuli at the right, we saw that there is a big difference. Where the inhibitory stimuli are really the main cause, to say, for the decline, the total decline in vasomotor task performance. So we know that mental fatigue, so here we can conclude that mental fatigue affected their reaction time. So it was for all stimuli due to the inhibitory. On the other hand, there were no changes in the flanker task due to condition. There were some changes due to the time of the flanker task, but not due to condition, which was a bit unexpected for us to say. It could be that the task was boring for them, that they had more, that they were more motivated for the vasomotor task performance. So we have there, we don't have at this moment really an explanation on why there is a difference in the vasomotor task performance, but not within the flanker task. But nevertheless, we know that are subjectively mentally fatigued. On a behavioral level, our hypothesis was partly confirmed. So we have to look at hypothesis 3 for the objective outcome measures of mental fatigue. But there, unfortunately, as we just finished the gathering of the data, we only were able to analyze the data of 6 participants and only of some of the P3 components, which is the third and largest component of the event-related potential. But we choose for this component for this presentation because it has been connected to cognitive processes such as the attentional resources, also the decision making, the executive functions, and the motoric functions, which are all processes that are negatively impacted by MF. And here we see that there are some significant differences for the P3 component in 2 brain areas, where there is a decline in amplitude, which means that these areas, brain areas, are less active when they are mentally fatigued. So at this moment, I can only give you a temporary conclusion, is that mental fatigue was successfully induced by on a subjective level, that there is a decline in the vasomotor task performance, and that the preliminary results are promising, but that there is further analysis needed to really confirm these objective measures for mental fatigue. So I would say it is a work in progress, and I hope by the end of the month that we will have submitted a paper in order to make a step into the mechanisms behind mental fatigue, and that we can as such, go further into the brain mechanisms behind mental fatigue and how it affects performance. So I thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, I will be glad to answer them.
Thank you very much. Very good presentation. Impressive amount of work.
Thank you.
Has gone into these experiments. Are there any questions amongst our panelists? Yes, Marcus.
So thank you very much. I have one question. Why table tennis players?
Mm-hmm. Actually, it has a lot of advantages for us. At our research group, we already did some experiments with badminton players. And we wanted to look at the EEG while they were performing the activity. And for table tennis players, the advantage is that they are standing still at the front of the table. So for the noise at the EEG data, it is a big advantage. While doing a badminton performance, they have to run back and forth, which is not really to advise when using EEG. So the table tennis players, as we know, that it is a sport-specific performance, a psychomotor performance that we also saw in another study of Lemansek that it was affected by mental fatigue. We choose for the table tennis players. It's just the advantages of keeping the EEG while they were performing their activity.
To extend my question, would you expect different results when you use just normal control persons doing the same task?
So not super elite.
Exactly.
Yeah, it is really a point of discussion at this moment that mental fatigue can affect more experienced people. That it can affect more non-experienced people than experienced people. There have been some studies where elite cyclists did not have any disadvantage of mental fatigue in when they were looking, when they were comparing them with non-elite cyclists. So it can be that there is a difference, but here we choose to include super elite table tennis players, because we know that mental fatigue has more influence on what they are, what they always do as such. When you use someone who is not experienced in table tennis player, the effect of mental fatigue we expect will be greater, will be bigger, because they were not, everything is new to them, so the effect of mental fatigue will be bigger for them. That's what we expect, but it's really a point of discussion, and I think that in the future there will be some studies who will more elaborate on that, and also hopefully looking at the EEG data while doing that.
Yes, Peter. Talking
about EEG, thanks for your nice study. You told us that the free Peter, did you start?
Go ahead. That's fine.
Sorry, I did not see anything on my screen. When you talked about EEG, you told us that the frequency bands are not so interesting for you because the time resolution is not so good, and the event-related potentials are better. But when you take fatigue, I think, why is it so time critical? Why do you think you have to be have a time resolution of some milliseconds and not some seconds or minutes?
Mm-hmm. What I wanted to say is that the spectral power analysis is more an average over time, and that we cannot know if the mental fatigue is higher or at the same level at the beginning of the task or at the end of the task. We can say that alpha frequency or theta frequency during this task post mental fatigue was higher, but was it at the same level before and after? And the second part for looking at the event-related potential is that we know that from the studies of Marcola that the RPE is affected, plays a role within mental fatigue, and that these RPE are generated within the center motor commands, which are reflected in the movement-related cortical potentials, which is an ERP. So it would be interesting to see if these ERPs are really affected and if they play a role within the feeling of the RPE. So we have to be, we want to see if there is anything that plays a role and which could give some clarification on mental fatigue.
Very good. Yeah, that's a good point. And my other question was, you said you don't have an idea why you didn't find anything in the flanker task. So do you have any, have you made a little literature research on the ability to, for example, if you do motor learning transfer of any psychological tests, if you're getting better in attention, can you transfer that? Or do you have any ideas?
I think one of the biggest reason, or two biggest reason, as I said, I think first of all it was a bit too boring for them. The flanker tasks are five arrows that you see on the screen, and you have to respond as fast as possible in which direction the arrow is pointing. It's for people who are not really busy with doing sports and have to react as fast as possible, such as table tennis players. They always have to react as fast as possible and to have a good accuracy. So I think that this task was also too easy for them. They already had a high, they already have a high level of being a high level of reacting as fast and as accurate as possible because of their sport. And I think that that translates a bit into other cognitive tasks, such as the flanker task. Because of what I said from other studies, these were always with normal people, so not elite, sub-elite table tennis players. So I think that's why that there was a difference between that there was an effect from mental fatigue on the flanker task performance.
Yeah. I think you made very many assumptions about the status of the table tennis players. And as Markus made the remark, it would be very good to have a control group. Then you could answer that more clearly, I guess.
Yeah, so, yeah. It's an important step. It would be an addition. Yeah. I'll write it down, and will be sure that I'll discuss it with my promoter.
Very good. Peter, sorry that I disrupted.
Peter, last question. Thank you.
I think my question is answered. Thank you.
Okay.
I'd just like to make one last comment in relation to the training status of the players. Another one also to look at it. I was wondering whether your task was not too standardized to look at an effect of mental fatigue. So if you have a task where automation is possible, maybe you decrease your chances to see this effect.
You mean the visuomotor task performance?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the visuomotor task performance was not, it was standardized in the way that the timing between each light was or 4 or 5 or 6 seconds, but the order of the lights was randomized. So they were used to the task, but not the the chronological order of the task. So that was always the surprise effect.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the questions.
And we will now listen to the next presentation from Alberto Main Galindo. And this presentation is titled Acute Effects on Creatine Kinase, Perceived Fatigue and Physical Performance on Different Post-Exercise Recovery Methods in Elite Basketball Players, a Crossover Randomized Control Trial. Alberto, the floor is yours. We could see your slides very well initially.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay.
And we see your PowerPoint.
I'm sorry.
Okay, very good.
Thank you very much for your introduction. Before starting with the presentation, I would like to thank the possibility of being here talking at one of the most important congress in sports science and being nominated to the Young Investigator Awards. Good morning, everyone. My name is Alberto Marín Galindo. I'm a pre-doctoral researcher belonging to the MOVID Research Group at the University of Cádiz in Spain. To talk about basketball is to talk about one of the most popular and practiced sports in the world. In this sport, there are very high intensity technical actions, which generate a great accumulation of fatigue and muscle damage. In recent years, the competition calendar has been condensed. And this has increased the accumulation of fatigue and the risk of injury. Even though the training is the main tool to increase performance and prevent injuries, there are different post-exercise recovery methods that have been shown to be effective for the same purpose. Specifically in basketball, the muscle study recovery methods are called water baths, active recovery, supplements of protein and carbohydrates, and stretching. These methods have been shown to quickly recover sports performance and reduce muscle damage. Knowing the recovery methods that have been effective in previous studies, the aim of the study was to compare the effects of cold water immersion the intake of carbohydrates and protein and active recovery on different post-exercise recovery parameters in elite basketball players, including creatine kinase measurements, self-perceived fatigue, and sports performance tests such as jumping, sprinting, agility, and strength test. A total of 15 professional male basketball players participate in the study. The inclusion criteria were: have been playing basketball for at least 10 years, have been training during the season 4 days a week, not have suffered serious illness or injuries, and have trained and compete regularly during the season. The exclusion criteria were having suffered an injury during the season and don't go through all treatment groups during the intervention. For this study, we used a randomized crossover design in which the participants were randomly divided into four groups in which they were administered four types of post-exercise protocol treatments: three recovery methods, cold water immersion, active recovery, and supplementation with protein and carbohydrates, and a placebo. Each week, the participants rotate groups and receive a different treatment. Right after the post-exercise measurements, the different recovery methods were applied to the participants. Active recovery was carried out using a cycle ergometer for 25 minutes at 50% of the maximum heart rate. Cold water immersion was performed with all legs in cold water at 11 degrees in periods of two minutes submerged and 2 minutes out of the water, repeating this process 5 times. Carbohydrate with protein supplementation was a mixture of 0.3 grams by kilogram of maltodextrin and 0.2 grams by kilogram of neutral whey protein in half a liter of water. And the placebo group ingested a drink of half a liter of water with a sweetener. The duration of all the treatment was 25 minutes. In this study, we measure blood parameters and some variables of physical performance, fatigue, and perception of exertion. The blood parameters that were measured were lactate and creatine kinase. VAS fatigue scale and the perceived exertion scale questionnaire were used to measure fatigue and exertion perception. And the physical performance variables that were measured were 10-meter sprint test, 4x10-meter agility test, squat jump, counter movement jump with arms action, a Balakov jump, and isometric strength in half squat. Both physical performance variables and blood parameters were measured before and immediately after the exercise protocol and after 24 hours. On the other hand, fatigue and exertion perception were taken before and immediately after the exercise protocol, just after the application of the corresponding recovery method and after 24 hours. The exercise protocol that the participants carried out before applying the recovery method was a circuit composed of some technical actions as different types of basketball specific movements with and without the ball, jumps and ball throws. The athlete had to perform 5 sets of 5 repetitions with rests or 30 seconds between repetitions and a minute between each set. They must perform this circuit as fast as possible. Regarding the statistical analysis, we use a 3x4 repeated measures analysis of variance for creatine kinase and physical performance. We use a 4x4 repeat measures ANOVA for the analysis of the variables of fatigue and exertion perception. And to know exactly where the significant difference were found, we use the Bonferroni post hoc test. We consider a statistically significant difference when p-value was less than 0.05 with a 95% confidence interval. When we analyze the data, we observe some interesting results. We observe a significant increase in creatine kinase values in all the measurements for all treatment groups, except for cold water immersion, which did not increase significantly at 24 hours compared to the post-exercise measurement. When we analyze the rate of perceived exertion, it was observed that values decreased significantly immediately after the application of the recovery method in all groups, but only in the cold water immersion group, these values were similar to pre-values. On the other hand, for the fatigue perception, a significant increase in its value was observed after the exercise protocol, but for the cold water immersion, active recovery and supplementation groups, these values decreased significantly after the recovery method application. In the physical performance variables, only in the 4x10 meters agility test, a significant decrease in the test time was observed in 24-hour post measurements compared to the post values. And finally, although no significant difference were observed, when we analyze the performance of a sprint test, we observe a negative or neutral trend as the hours passed, except when cold water immersion was used, where performance tend to increase 24 hours later. The conclusions that we draw after analyzing the results of our study are that cold water immersion is the most effective method to reduce muscle damage derived from exercise, measured through creatine kinase. Furthermore, cold water immersion seems to be the only one that could reduce performance loss in agility and the sprint test and improve the rate of perceived exertion quickly. Both cold water immersion active recovery or supplementation with carbohydrates and protein are effective in rapidly reducing the perception of fatigue. And finally, larger samples researches are needed to confirm these results and offer other relevant conclusions, comparing different recovery methods and training protocols. And before concluding, I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope you found this presentation interesting. And if anyone has any doubts or questions, I'm at your disposal, both here and by email if you wish. Thank you.
It was a very interesting presentation, Alberto. Very heavy protocol again, very nice. Congratulations for doing this amount of work. Has anyone a question? If not, yeah, please, welcome.
Thanks for this nice study. Maybe I'm wrong, but if I got the study design, the 15 subjects did every method. So it was a crossover design. They did the cold water immersion. They did the supplementation. That's right.
Yes, yes.
So, and they did 4 times the fatiguing protocol. But if I got the numbers, the baseline after the fatiguing protocol, they seemed quite different sometimes. So I was wondering whether they participated in the fatiguing protocol always in the same kind of way, or whether they got bored after time, or it was too hard.
Can you repeat, please, the question?
So when I look at the values, I think it was, it could be sprint time or it could be the squat jump. So after the, or even creatine kinase, if you look after the fatiguing protocol, the values look different between the different sessions.
Between participants.
No, it's always the same participants, isn't it? You always test 15 participants, always the same. Is it like this?
Yes, yes, yes.
So these participants, they do 4 times a fatiguing protocol.
Yes.
And did they participate in the same way in each fatiguing protocol? Can you say they had the same decline after each fatiguing protocol, or were there differences?
I don't understand you, sorry.
In other words, you know, every time your subject repeated the fatiguing protocol, do you think that they push as hard every time?
I don't understand.
Okay.
Well, we can switch to perhaps another question, or you want to reformulate, Wolfgang? Or
is it possible to go back to a slide to see
yes.
that, or is that?
Could you please show your results slide?
Is your question that everyone do the exercise protocol at the same intensity each week?
Yes.
Yes. We control the intensity and the effort with the heart rate and seeing the lactate values.
Okay.
And week by week, the same participant have to the similar values.
Okay, perfect. And now you've chosen different methods for recovery. Have you thought of combining them? Because it would be very easy to have a protein supplementation and do the cold water immersion also. So I would say if the two of them have an effect, combining them would be perhaps even better. Combining cold water immersion with protein supplementation, what do you think about that?
I don't know. In the literature, there aren't studies that compare these different protocols. To my knowledge, this is the first study that combine totally different recovery methods. And what I had seen is studies that compare, for example, different baths protocols or different supplements protocol, but it is the first study that compared different, totally different recovery methods.
Yeah, it's very impressive. It's a very good study. Thanks.
Are there any more questions? I have a question in your design. So you have this water immersion protocol, then you have the active recovery, and then you have these supplements. But arguably, I mean, you can argue that the active recovery and the water immersion are targeting the same physiological mechanism, but the supplementation is this also targeting the same mechanism for recovery?
I don't understand well your question.
So, for example, you could argue that I don't know, but cold water immersion and active recovery would decrease inflammation, for example, and that's the way you would achieve recovery. But how would you say that your supplementation protocol enabled recovery?
Supplementation with protein and carbohydrate may improve the muscle protein synthesis, and it can sorry my English is
no, no worries. What I was trying to establish is whether you had conditions that actually could be compared. So, you know, you're comparing active recovery, water, cold water immersion, and this carbohydrate supplementation, and arguably also this placebo, which is a drink. So I was wondering whether you could put all these conditions on the same level for the comparison in your experiment, but
and I understand you. It's but it's I'm not find the words in English.
No worries. So. We'll just leave it. Thank you very much again, and it's time for our last speaker. And this will be Alex Fages. And the title of Alex's presentation is Effects of Transcranial Direct Current Stimulation on the Maximal Capacities of the Neuromuscular System to Produce Force, Velocity, and Power. Alex, it's your turn.
Okay. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So, hello, I'm Carlos Alix, a PhD student from Spain. It's a really big pleasure to be here, and I hope you will like our work. Effects of transcranial direct current stimulation on the maximal capacities of the neuromuscular system to produce force, velocity, and power. As we all know, the nervous system controls the muscle force production, and it do that by modulating the motor unit recruitment and also the firing rates. But what would happen if we modulate some part of the nervous system that is involved in the production of muscle force in that physical action that voluntary? Transcranial direct current stimulation, TDCS, is a non-invasive, painless, and safe brain stimulation that consists in applying a weak electrical current over the scalp of the subjects through two or more electrodes, and TDCS has demonstrated to have inhibitory or excitatory effects by tending the resting membrane potential of the targeted cortical neurons. Anodal TDCS can increase cortical excitability, while cathodal TDCS can produce the opposite effect. We ran out a systematic review and meta-analysis, and we found that TDCS tend to improve maximal voluntary contraction performance, but greater effects were found when looking for the effects of TDCS on endurance tasks. A problem is that strength tasks have been less investigated. Also, only three studies have investigated the effects of TDCS on sprint performance, and all of them were performed in a cycle ergometer, not running, and they all stimulated the primary motor cortex. Sasada and colleagues found that TDCS had no effect on an 8-second sprint task, but they found effects on longer endurance tasks. Also, Wang and colleagues found no effects of TDCS on the first sprint of a repeated sprint task, but they found ergogenic effects in the last four sprints. Also, Sasada and colleagues found no effects of anodal TDCS compared to some, that is placebo, when performing three sprint tasks separated by 2 minutes, but they found differences between anodal and cathodal TDCS. But what about running? And what about if we stimulate the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex? Because stimulating the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, different studies found ergogenic effects on resistant exercise, like elbow flexion exercise and leg raise exercise. But also, targeting the primary motor cortex, Lattari and colleagues found ergogenic effects on counter movement jump performance, and also Kamali and colleagues found ergogenic effects on one repetition performance and one repetition maximum performance. But what would happen if they would stimulate the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex? The aims of this compendium of studies were to explore the effects of anodal, cathodal, or some TDCS over the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex for 15 minutes at 2 milliamperes on the one repetition maximum estimated by velocity and the force velocity profile in bench press exercise. Also in counter movement jump performance in height and peak power, and also in sprint performance and horizontal force velocity profile. For all these three studies, anodal, cathodal, oral sum, placebo, TDCS over the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex for 15 minutes at 2 milliamperes was applied over the scalp of the subjects, and all the subjects were healthy and they could not train 2 days before the experimental session or intake coffee or any other stimulant substances. A double-blind crossover design was used for the three randomized controlled studies. In the first study, 14 resistance trained men came to 3 experimental sessions because they were already familiarized with all the protocol. First of all, they warmed up, and after that, one repetition maximum estimated by velocity and force velocity profile were measured with a linear transductor. After that, TDCS was applied, and then the first step and the second step were repeated. In the second study, 17 healthy men came to 1 familiarization session and 3 experimental sessions. In the beginning of the session, they warmed up, then 3 trials of counter movement jump were performed, and height and peak power were measured, and after that, TDCS was applied. Finally, step 1 and step 2 were repeated. In study 3, 32 sports science students, 25 males and 7 females, came to 1 familiarization session and 3 experimental sessions, performing the TDCS protocol at the beginning of the session, and they warmed up after that, and finally, sprint performance and force velocity profile were measured using 4 pairs of photoelectrical cells. The results of the first study were that any condition of the non-invasive brain stimulation affected to the one repetition maximum estimated by velocity or any parameter of the force velocity profile. Also, in the second study, we found no effect of TDCS on height and peak power performance. And finally, sprint performance and any parameter of the force velocity profile were not affected by TDCS. The present work revealed that 15 minutes of anodal or cathodal TDCS applied over the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex at 2 milliamperes does not affect the maximal capacities of the neuromuscular system to produce force, velocity, and power on jumping, sprinting, and bench press lifting. It is logical because in our meta-analysis we found that TDCS ergogenic effects are present in longer tasks. And also, Sasada and colleagues found no effects on the sprint task, but ergogenic effects in longer tasks. Also, Wang and colleagues found no effects on the first sprint, but when subjects were fatigued after the first sprint, the rest of them were enhanced by TDCS. So maybe TDCS only work with longer endurance tasks that could be affected by higher supraspinal fatigue or higher RPE levels. So also the proposed mechanism of TDCS are that TDCS increase cortical excitability and then optimize motor unit recruitment. Maybe it's not right because temporal and dorsolateral prefrontal cortex TDCS has also been shown to improve physical performance. TDCS does not always modulate cortical excitability, and even if it's modulated, TDCS could not affect performance. Besides, TDCS can improve performance without affecting cortical excitability. So maybe we don't really know the main mechanisms of TDCS, and maybe it only works when we are fatigued in our central nervous system and RPE is increased. Also, TDCS can induce expected or unexpected responses for each individual or even do nothing, because anodal TDCS, what is supposed to increase cortical excitability, could also decrease cortical excitability or do nothing. Compensatory responses between signaling in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and motor cortex to maintain the intercortical homeostasis by reorganizing neuronal activity has been shown, so maybe Even if we affect cortical excitability, our nervous system could reorganize the neural activity to reach homeostasis. Or maybe it's just that TDCS doesn't work. It would be hard because I have been investigating this for a while, but maybe it's the truth. So in conclusion, 15 minutes of anodal or cathodal TDCS applied over the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex at 2 milliamperes does not affect the maximal capacities of the neuromuscular system to produce force, velocity, and power on jumping, sprinting, and bench press lifting. So don't stimulate your dorsolateral prefrontal cortex before going to the gym. Thank you, and I'm ready for your questions.
Thank you. Another very nice presentation. Are there any questions amongst our panelists? Yes, Wolfgang.
Thanks for your very nice study.
Thank you.
I'm curious whether you have categorized your subjects depending whether they are responder, non-responder, or even negative responder. Have you done anything like that? Because it's done so often in the literature.
Yeah, we did. We did it. If I'm honest, I don't remember the exact number and percentage of the subjects, but I remember around an 80% average were not affected by TDCS.
So not affected, you mean with the excitability?
No, we know about performance.
Performance.
Performance. We didn't measure cortical excitability, but we are doing it right now.
Yeah. Okay. And I think in your previous review, you speculated that TDCS would affect the perception of fatigue. Can you say something about that?
Yeah, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is involved in how we manage with sensations and emotions that we have during the sport or the physical task. So maybe modulating the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, we could manage better that emotions and the afferent 3 or 4 sensations that came from peripheral signals to our central nervous system could be better managed, and maybe the cognitive sources of the subjects to continue doing the exercise and to continue doing the high intensity of the exercise could be better.
Okay, and so it would not play any role in short sports actions like you measured now?
It's what I think.
No. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marcus.
Thank you very much, Carlos. I totally agree with your conclusion, by the way. But I have 2 small questions with respect to your methodological design. The first one is about how you ensured that it's double blinded. So what was exactly the protocol?
Yeah, perfect. Sorry, because it were a lot of data and I could not specifically talk about that. But yeah, I was applying the TDCS. Another 2 colleagues were performing the protocol, the physical protocols with them, but I were not there. I were in another room of our laboratory, and they didn't know anything about the condition. And also the person that analyzed the data, that was me, didn't know what the data, like they classified the data in the physical task measurements, and they sent the data to me without any specific word or any specific data about the condition that I was analyzing.
Okay, perfect. And then my second question is about your how you measured the jump performance. You mentioned an app, so My Jump app.
Yeah.
What is it and how valid is it, and how exactly does it work?
Yeah, it's validated by Carlos Balsalobre. It's an app that it can only be used with a smartphone of like latest smartphone, because we need a lot of photograms per second to be precise with the measurements. And yeah, it's validated by Carlos Balsalobre Fernandez, and it had been I think 5 or 6 different studies replied his results. And it was validated with the gold standard. We also, it's not included here because we have problem with that data, but we at the same time measure with my sprint, my jump up, and we measure with a force platform, and there was no significant differences between the data.
Okay, thank you very much.
Are there any further questions? I had one that was similar to Wolfgang, so I think we'll just stop here. Thank you very much, Alex, again for your presentation.
Thank you very much.